Hi, this is Scott Wilkinson, host of Home Theater Geeks. In episode 224, I chat with Mike Heiss, Mark Henninger, and Tom Norton about what we all saw and heard at the Cedia Expo. So stay tuned.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for Home Theater Geeks is provided by Cashfly at cachefly.com.
This is Home Theater Geeks with Scott Wilkinson, recorded September 18th, 2014. Episode 224, Cedia 2014 Roundup. Hey there, Scott Wilkinson here, the Home Theater Geek and editor of avsforum.com. This week, I have three guest geeks on the show. We've all just come from the Cedia Expo trade show in Denver, Colorado, and we're going to be talking about all the stuff we saw and heard there. First up is Michael Heiss, M. Heiss in the chat room, for those of you who are in the chat room, an industry consultant and a jolly good Cedia fellow. Welcome back, Mike.
Thanks, Scott. Always a pleasure to be on with you.
Next up is Mark Henninger, a senior writer and social media manager at AVS Forum, and a fellow upon whom I greatly depend at AVS. Hey, Mark, welcome back.
Hi, Scott. Nice to be here.
You bet. Nice to have you. And finally, Tom Norton, a senior editor at soundandvision.com and Sound and Vision magazine, who has also been on the show a number of times. Hey, Tom, welcome back.
Hey, good. How are you, Scott?
Good, thank you. So those of you who are tuned in live at live.twit.tv or logged into the chat room at irc.twit.tv can post questions for us as we go, and I will pass along as many as I can. So I think all of you would agree that this Cedia show, 2014, was one of the primary things there was Dolby Atmos for the home. Clearly, it's been out in the theaters for a couple years, and basically what it does is it adds speakers on the ceiling or overhead sounds to provide a three-dimensional hemispherical sound field all around the audience. And it's been in the commercial cinema for a couple of years, as I said. Now it's coming to home theaters. And man, oh man, there were a dozen demos from different companies of Dolby Atmos. I just wanted to quickly show people before we get started about talking about what was at the show. I have a couple of diagrams called Dolby Overhead and Dolby Upfiring. Just to show people what the difference is, you can implement it in two ways. Okay, this one's called Dolby Overhead, and it's basically a 7.1 audio system on the ground, just on the floor, like as we normally would have, plus four speakers on the ceiling. And these speakers on the ceiling fire downward. And the music mix is mixed in such a way that there are a number of objects like helicopters or rainstorms or thunder or whatever that can be placed anywhere in the three-dimensional sound space. And the renderer, the electronics, put that sound into the speakers that are necessary to make it seem like it's coming from that direction. Now, this is how the theaters do it, the commercial cinema do it. And you can do it at home as well if you have the ability to actually put speakers on your ceiling. That may be practical. It may be impractical. May have a low wife acceptance factor or spouse acceptance factor. So Dolby came up with this other idea, which was what are called up-firing speakers. And so instead of actually placing these speakers overhead, you have these little, you have extra speakers on top of your speakers on the floor, and they're firing upward into the ceiling, and that sound then gets reflected back down to the audience, to the listeners. And it produces more or less the same effect. But we're going to talk about the differences of those two approaches as we get into this show. So I just wanted to make sure everybody understood what about Dolby Atmos. That's kind of the basics in a nutshell. So, Mark, I believe you had as your goal at the show to go hear every Dolby Atmos demo Did you succeed?
I made it to 10. I didn't succeed in going to every single demo.
Okay. All right.
I was there in demos till the last minute and actually like ducked out of the very last demo into a cab and into an airplane.
Well, that's dedication and I love it. I follow that same path myself. Okay. So just tell us, give us a little bit of an impression of what you thought of the various demos. Oh, by the way, all of us are going to reveal what we thought was the best audio demo and the best video demo that we saw and heard at the show, but not till the end of the show. So you got to stick around. But anyway, give us a sort of an overview of some of the demos you heard and what were some of the differences and how people approached it.
I heard a lot of demos that proved that it's a valid technology. In other words, I want Atmos. I didn't get sick of listening to those clips. In fact, I was fascinated by the fact that there was a chance for all of these manufacturers to play the exact same material in their setups. I don't think that happens to this degree, you know, every year. So,
no, in fact, Dolby has released a demo disc that has these clips on it that everybody was using. And they announced at the show that Blu-ray with Atmos is coming. And by the way, it will play on any regular Blu-ray player, which is cool. You don't need to upgrade your Blu-ray player. You do need to upgrade your speakers and your AVR, your AV receiver or pre-pro, which we'll talk about in a bit. But Transformers Age of Extinction is the first Blu-ray that will come out with Dolby Atmos. But until then, all we have is this demo disc. So you're right. All of the manufacturers were playing the same material.
Yes, and AVS even had that special demo from Dolby where they gave us this disc. And that was really nice because I got to come home and listen to those same clips in my own system, which, of course, does not have Atmos, and have that as a reference to what I heard at Cedia, which helped even more reinforce, you know, the fact that I had been listening to a 3D sound field, and when I came home, I was listening to a 2D sound field. That's really great. And I was even happier to hear great demos from one stood out, Onkyo. They just use what I would call even a pedestrian definitive technology setup, and that sounded great, even though there was the back wall was open to the shore, the show floor. I heard Pioneer's upward firing speakers, which sounded really great, and you were talking about the ceiling speakers and spousal effect, acceptance factors. That's one solution that would work, and a similar technology was on an Onkyo home theater in a box. So if you're just a college student in dorm room, I guess, Atmos is not out of reach. And yet at the high end, there were six-figure, Atmos demos. Steinway Lingdorf, for example, had a $120,000 system on display. So it was really amazing to see Atmos go from, a very inexpensive home theater in a box all the way up to a highly prestigious, high-end, six-figure system. And again, hear the exact same content on all of them. Very interesting.
I have to say that's one of the key things about going to Cedia that I think is so important is hearing these demos, which otherwise you might not really be able to hear. Dolby is saying that some retailers are going to have Atmos demos in their store, Magnolia within Best Buy in particular. But boy, to hear the range of offerings from inexpensive to uber expensive. And as you say, playing the same material, it's a remarkable opportunity. Mike, how many Atmos demos did you make it to?
Not as many as Mark. I was a little busy.
Yeah, you're a little busy. As a Cedia fellow, you have some other responsibilities, including teaching some classes.
I'm afraid so.
Yeah, exactly. Well, give us your impression of what you did here then about Atmos.
Well, I think I see that there are a lot of people, and I noticed this in the chat room, there are a lot of people that are, I wouldn't say anti-Atmos as much as they're not pro-Atmos. And the thing that
I
heard...
Perhaps calling them skeptical?
You know, that's fine. The thing I heard that convinced me about Atmos, and I've been aware of it for a while and heard it and all of that, was not something I heard, but something I didn't hear. After the last day of the show, going around trying to catch up on missed demos, I went to about three or four of them in a row, the Golden Ears and the JBL and a bunch of others. And then I went to see the Sony demo with the stacked 1100s where they were playing the FIFA reel. And that was really great video, but there was something missing. And there you are in the bowl of, I forget the name of the big stadium in Rio where they did the finals. And I was missing the immersive sound that I heard in all the Atmos demos. And wow. I think that that's something that other people haven't had an opportunity to do that close of an AV comparison. And I think that really makes the point about Atmos that you don't know. It's like Yogi Berra. You don't know you have it until you don't have it. Another one of the demos, which may be one, Mark, I don't know if you heard this one, was Analog Devices in their offsite demo room had a Denon AVR and the Atlantic Technologies modules, which were the upfiring speakers sitting on top of some other Atlantic standard speakers. And it was in a small hotel meeting room about the size of an average consumer's den. And it really worked. It with the up-firing speakers, it really did work.
Scott and I went to that demo together. It was one of a couple of demos that we managed to see concurrently. And here. And I agree. You know, that and that's the thing. I wasn't disappointed by any of the demos, nor was I disappointed by, you know, either of the technologies, in ceiling or reflective. I think it, you know, for the debut of a technology and for it to be that, you know, and like you said, I miss it. So there it is. It works. It works in multiple levels and multiple implementations, and I miss it already. That's really great.
If people hear it and say they don't like it, that's cool. I mean, that's America. But I just would really encourage anyone who hasn't heard it to give it a listen before they say this isn't for me.
Exactly.
I have to say, and one comment I like to make is that I found that the ones that I only got to six, or maybe seven, I guess
only.
Lost track. Yeah. And well, I have to say I got sick and tired of the Star Trek clip, but I understand the logic.
Yeah, I kind of did too.
but yeah, because I'd seen it up half a dozen times before the show, so yeah. You know, it added up. But I have to say that of the demos I did see, I thought the ones with the discrete speakers in the ceiling were the best. And I think I understand why they went with the reflective, what they called, you know, Atmos enabled speakers, because right. otherwise you wouldn't get you wouldn't go anywhere with the in the market with only ceiling speakers, because most people wouldn't do it.
Right, exactly. Now I would say that probably, well, certainly a very large percentage of AVS members probably will do it, because A, they're super geeks, and B, very often they have acoustic treatments in their ceiling. And in that case, up-firing speakers, those reflective speakers, wouldn't work, because the acoustic treatment in the ceiling would prevent the reflection. So I think at AVS, you're going to see a higher percentage of people doing those actual in-ceiling or ceiling speakers as opposed to the up-firing. But I think Dolby was very wise in coming up with this alternative for those who can't do it. Now, of course, you do have a limitation on the ceiling. The type of ceiling that you can use, it has to be, I think they say, between 8 and 14 feet tall, flat, and relatively reflective. And if it's not, if you have vaulted ceilings or something like that, then those up-firing speakers aren't going to work either. So,
well, there was one interesting point, if I could just poke something in here, Scott. In
sure.
The panel discussion that I did with Wilfried Van Balen, the inventor of Oro, Brett Crockett, the lead guy on Atmos, Andrew Jones, and Floyd Toole for Debunction Junction. One of the things that somebody asked from the floor, and Tom was there, we were talking about whether or not acoustic treatment that's already in a room impacts the success of either Oro or Atmos. And one of the folks, I don't remember which, maybe Tom, you do, said if you put a diffuser right up in the top of the ceiling, that that also helps with these reflective speakers. So it, it is installation, you know, dependent.
Yes,
I don't remember,
exactly.
I don't remember who said that either, but yeah, I remember the comment.
Yeah. Tom, so your impression basically was you generally preferred the overhead speakers, the actual speakers overhead, as opposed to the upfiring speakers. Did you have any other sort of general impressions about Atmos itself as a technology?
Well, I've, with the limited source material available, I was quite impressed by it. It's something I'll certainly want to try and set up in my own home, but I have to get the saws out and cut holes in the ceiling.
You're going to go for the ceiling approach, I can tell.
Right.
Yeah, okay, very good. And as Mark, as you pointed out, there were some really big ones, Steinway-Lingdorf, and Harman, JBL in particular, were these gigantic, well, they weren't really huge rooms, but they were gigantic systems, six-figure systems. And then we had smaller ones like Golden Ear, I think, Mike, you mentioned that. I guess Onkyo, was that kind of a smaller room system as well?
Onkyo, but that wasn't enclosed. Integra was enclosed. The Denon was enclosed. You know, Denon Marantz was enclosed. Yamaha had a small room demo. So there were plenty of small room demos.
Yeah, well, which is great. Again, providing a wide range of possible types of installations to demonstrate the possibility. Now, with all of these Atmos demos, and Dolby themselves had one as well in a relatively small room, and they did an interesting thing, which was they had both actual ceiling speakers and upfiring speakers, and they compared the two, which I thought was fascinating. I know, Mark, you heard it. Mike, did you get to hear that one?
Yes, I did. And it's the same demo that we heard out in Burbank before Expo. And the thing that it's, I always find interesting is that more people, when they do the show of hands, seem to prefer the upfiring speakers or just can't tell the difference.
Right, right.
I'm in the, Tom, I'm in the minority.
You're in the minority.
I'm in the minority. I still prefer the ceiling speakers.
Okay, like, even I guess, in the
day. I agree. I prefer the ceiling.
I can see one possible disadvantage of the ceiling speakers, and that would be if you're sitting right under one of the ceiling speakers, there's no diffusion there, and it might be like sitting right next to a surround speaker.
Well, yes, or sitting in an Oro theater.
Yeah.
We're going to get to that in just a second. We're going to get to that in just a second, but I do want to reinforce that point that Tom just made, which is that I heard a lot of people say, man, I was sitting right under one of those overhead speakers and I could tell right away that it was blasting right down on the top of my head. Whereas somebody else sitting in the quote sweet spot might not say that. So it's installation dependent and it's where you're sitting, dependent upon where you're sitting. Tom?
That might be an ideal location. I could see some speaker manufacturer coming up with something like this for a small omnidirectional speaker for the ceiling.
Oh, yeah. You and I were talking about that on the way to the airport. An actual omnidirectional speaker in the ceiling, maybe in the center of the ceiling, doing its Atmos thing.
Yes, 30 years ago, JVC made a ball shaped about a foot in diameter omnidirectional speaker that had four I think they were probably 4-inch woofers and four tweeters in it, and they really worked omnidirectionally. I mean, there's obviously no true omnidirectional speaker, but it did a pretty good job. And stereo back then was all we were doing, but something like that. I actually think I saw some of those at when we went to an event in Korea. It wasn't obviously they weren't Korean speakers, but they were like in a hotel or a meeting room or something. They've probably been there for years.
Mm-hmm. But that's and everything old is new again. I mean, when I was working with Jim Fosgate, oh my goodness, you know, 15 or more years ago, on what became not Logic 7. My brains are melted. Six access. And Jim was always a big proponent of height speakers. We just never got to actualize it because the technology didn't exist to get in the mix at the time.
If you look at recently, I wrote about what do they call that? 3D printing. One of the things that people have been making are those like soccer ball style omnidirectional speakers.
You know,
with their 3D printers, yeah.
Wow, that's pretty cool. Talk about your DIY. Beatmaster in the chat room is asking about, are the room sizes limited in range for the upfiring solution? And they are in terms of the ceiling height. You do need a certain ceiling height. And I don't think you would want to use that in a gigantic room. But, you know, your normal home theater kind of room, you know, it might work. I heard a lot of people say that the upfiring speakers, when in Dolby's demo, when we went back and forth between the actual ceiling speakers and the upfiring speakers tended to be a little more diffuse and not as precise in their localization. At least that's what I heard.
There was one company that showed a ceiling speaker. It wasn't designed for Atmos. It was just a company I'd never heard of before called True Audio. The cabinet, what it was a ceiling speaker on a pendant. It was mounted so the speaker fired downward, but there was actually an enclosure behind it. If you picture those that are familiar with the BMW's 800 series speakers with their oddly shaped mid-range enclosure, if you took that and turned it 90 degrees and mounted it with the small end toward the ceiling and the speaker firing downward, that's about what I saw. And you could use that as a ceiling speaker and mount it at any height from the ceiling if you had a high ceiling.
It may be goony. I like the suggestion someone has in the chat room. Get an old Hammond Wesley, turn it upside down, mount it to the ceiling.
Oh, man. You better have some serious bracing on that thing. Because in college, I played in at least one band that we had to move a Hammond B3 and a Leslie around. And, man, that was no fun at all.
you need four of them.
Yeah, and you need four of them. one other point I want to make about Atmos before moving on is there were a number of companies showing in-ceiling speakers, as there always are at CEDIA. I mean, this is the Custom Electronics Design and Installation Association. So custom builds are what the show is all about. And so a lot of people have in-ceiling speakers. A new company called Origin had some in-ceiling speakers. This is a new company from Jeremy Burkhart, who used to run Speakercraft. Which is also well known for architectural speakers, as they're called. And he was touting the fact that his speakers have a very wide dispersion, which would make them, I think, very, very well suited to Atmos. And so that's one thing about in-ceiling speakers that I think was kind of cool. And, you know, if it were me, I probably would put in-ceiling speakers in my theater rather than putting the upfiring, only because in my particular theater, having back surrounds and having them out into the room a little bit, which is what they need to be for these upfiring speakers, wouldn't work very well because the back of my theater is the hallway from one part of the house to the other.
I would think in-ceiling speakers might actually, if they had a wide dispersion, they might actually work fairly well with a fairly high ceiling because, you know, the cone gets wider as you get further away from it, so you wouldn't have as much problem with sitting like underneath one of the speakers. It would be spread out a little more.
Yeah, exactly. Well, Tom, you referred to maybe having one speaker overhead, and there was in fact and is now coming to market another immersive audio system that in a sense competes with Atmos, and it's called Auro, A-U-R-O. And it has also been in the commercial cinema for some time. They don't have nearly as many installations in commercial cinemas as Atmos does. And there was one demo at CEDIA as opposed to a dozen Atmos demos. Mark, you went to the Auro demo, I believe, right?
Yes. Tell us about it. It was a heavy-duty demo. The system itself was comprised of James loudspeakers and amps from James loudspeakers, as well as from DataSat. And honestly, it was a very impressive demonstration. And Wilfried, the inventor of Auro, gave his demonstration, his explanation of what it does. He seemed to be a proponent of track-based mixing channel-based, right, and not so much, of being purely object-based. And, I mean, I can't speak to that. I can say that his demo was exceptional. I mean, last year, Wisdom Audio did a a demo in the same room, and I felt like this lived up to the dynamics and the clarity that I heard last year, but added the overhead effects. If I close my eyes and somebody said, you know, hey, this is Atmos and this is Oro, can you tell the difference? No, I wouldn't likely be able to tell the difference. It's another dimension. There it is. You know,
there it is. Okay. Mike is chomping at the bit to respond to that. I know. Go ahead.
Unless it's, you know, children of Israel, there are chariots behind you. That's okay. But the quality of the sound in the Oro demo, at least to my, you know, aging ears, was really good. No question about that. What I didn't enjoy as much was the transition between the layers. I found it a bit too obvious and not as seamless. There's one scene in the Red Bull clip in the Dolby disc where there's a Formula One racer going through the Holland Tunnel or the Lincoln Tunnel, and it goes down, and then it comes up, and then it goes up the grade as it exits the tunnel, and you can follow it seamlessly. But I think Oro did themselves a disservice because there were too many flyovers and helicopters, and I just didn't get the seamless sound field that I got from Atmos in the Oro demos.
Tom, before we get your opinion, Tom, I want to make sure that we show the graphic called Oro that shows how their speaker system is set up. You have your sort of regular surround system surrounding the audience. You have a second layer, what's called a height layer, above that, ringing the room. And then you have one speaker in the ceiling called Voice of God. And I must, because it's that time of year, I must play my shofar. And this is what would come out of the Voice of God speaker.
Tequila.
Yes, Mike. I should have had you announce the call. Thank you very much for doing that, Mike. This time of year, this is the next week starts the Jewish high holidays, and that's when the shofar is typically blown, so that is so appropriate coming from the Voice of God speaker, which is what it's called. Anyway, so Tom, did you hear the Oro demo?
Actually, I did not. I missed it. I got down there, and the timing was wrong, so I didn't get into it. But I did have one comment. I mean, we talked about this coming out of the airport on Sunday. One comment on Atmos versus Dolby as to which is appropriate for different things. I find that Dolby is probably it's mainly movie centric. It's designed for movies. It's great for movies. That's the way movies are mixed with, you know, objects all over the place and the object-oriented recording. If you want to capture a live concert, for instance, without fiddling with these channels after you're done, how do you object-orient that with Dolby? It would seem like Oro would be superior for that type of recording.
Interesting. Go ahead.
I really didn't mean to interject, but in the demo, in the Oro demo, they did what I had wished for in the Atmos demos, which is play music from a symphony orchestra recorded in a symphony hall and from an organ recorded in a church, with the immersive audio effect. And I really enjoyed that. And I truly wish that Dolby had shown something like that off.
But yeah. They didn't, with the pipe organ, it was all up here. You were looking up at the pipes and the sound was coming from the height speakers, and I just didn't feel as much sound in the lower layer. Again, my perception.
Right. I think it's a great question and issue to talk about music. I mean, as you said, the movies are where Atmos is at, and I think Oro too to a great degree, but if you put enough microphones out in the hall and simply record what's there, it could be very, very effective. One thing that I really thought, by the way, I didn't hear the Oro demo. It was down in the high-performance audio rooms. I didn't make it down there this trip. But one thing I was impressed with in some of the Dolby Atmos demos I heard was they did, in fact, play some music. On that demo disc, for example, there's a track by Enrique Iglesias, which was mixed in Oro. So the music is all around you. In the AVS exclusive Atmos demo at Dolby's booth, we also heard some examples of two-channel music being upmixed in a part of Atmos called Dolby Surround, which actually takes two-channel or 5.1 channel or 7.1 channel and upmixes it into the entire 3D space. And I found that to be extremely effective. Dolby also played for us another example of a music track mixed from the multi-track master into Atmos. I also found that very effective. Mark, you disagree with me right on that one.
No. Well, you're right. Dolby absolutely went into music in their demo. And so I guess I was speaking to the majority of the demos that were just using those little clips. I was afraid that people would react negatively to that mix. I was really surprised that people liked it. I thought it was going like almost too far. Mm-hmm. So all of a sudden I was rendered conservative in my taste in surround music, and I'm really I love it, and I'm a proponent of it. So funny. In retrospect, it was awesome. You know, I'm so glad that they went that far, and I'm glad you liked it.
I liked it a lot, absolutely. SoCal Ray Jr. in the chat room, who was also at the Atmos event at the AVS Atmos event and wandering around Cedia, writes the Oro demo had a lot of speakers. Well, so did the Harman demo, the Atmos demo. And they used very good demo material that had a lot of virtual space. So that was his comment about it, the virtual space. Sisden in the chat room is asking, would channel-based systems be less flexible for various room dimensions than object-based systems? It's kind of an interesting question. Anybody care to jump in on that?
Well, there's a big difference in what the suggested speaker placement is. And again, Tom, you were in the panel that we did on Friday. The height speakers recommended for Oro are kind of front and rear corners plus the voice of God. You've got a little bit more flexibility with Atmos. But I believe that somebody asked Wilfried and Brett Crockett if you could use one for the other and what the results would be. Nobody's had a chance to try it yet, or at least admitted to it. But they said that it should, and it'll be interesting to see.
Yeah, I agree. Sandblaster in the chat room is asking, with a great sound engineer, it would be amazing for the blind to experience the world that they may not be able to see. I hadn't thought of that before. What a great thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, listen, let's get to some other stuff that was at Cedia, because Atmos and Oro weren't the only things there, although they seem to be the kind of the dominant theme, I thought, this year anyway. The other big news for me was projectors. Now, Mark and I split coverage of the show on AVS Forum. And, of course, you can go to AVS Forum and read all our coverage, as well as to Sound and Vision, read all of Tom's coverage. And you guys had a bunch of people covering the show there. For us, it was just Mark and me. And Mark more or less went on the audio side of things, and I went on the video side of things. And I found that the other kind of big story at the show was projectors, video projectors, that used alternative light sources for their illumination. Most home theater projectors and even most commercial cinema digital projectors use lamps, basically white light lamps that white light is then split up into red, green, and blue one way or another. but there were a number of projectors this year at Cedia that used lasers as their light source. And it's kind of interesting how they work. The Epson LS10000 was the least expensive of these laser projectors. And there's a diagram that I put. There's a picture of the projector itself for those of you who are watching. But there's a diagram of the laser, how the lasers work. And if we can pull that up, there it is. So there are basically two arrays of blue laser diodes. And they're seen sort of near the bottom of this picture pointing inward. One of these arrays of blue lasers, takes laser light and shines it straight out, and that illuminates the blue imager. These projectors, most of them have three different imagers in them, one for the blue part of the picture, one for the red part, one for the green part. The other blue laser actually excites a yellow phosphor. Anybody who remember, well, plasmas use phosphors, old CRTs use phosphors. And in this case, the phosphor is excited by blue laser light. And when blue laser light hits that yellow phosphor, it glows yellow. And that yellow light is then split into red and green. And so the red part goes and illuminates the red imager, and the green part illuminates the green imager. And then those three color images are combined back together for a full color image and sent out the lens. This is also Epson's first what's called reflective projector, at least the first one that looks like it might actually come to market. They introduced one several years ago at CEDIA, and then it quietly disappeared. But this one looks pretty good. And so it's coming out. It's coming to market, and with a laser projection, laser light engine that should last, they're saying 30,000 hours, and that's in the eco mode. That's in the low power mode. If you want more brightness out of it, you're going to have to push it harder, and it won't last as long. But even at 10,000 hours, if you're watching 8 hours a day, 365 days a year, that's three and a half years. So if you back that off to four hours a day, 365 days a year, you're talking about 7 years. So there are people who are saying, oh, well, you should be able to replace the laser engine. And you can't in this particular case. But it wasn't the only one. Let me ask first of the panel, if you guys went in and saw the LS10000 laser projector. Tom, I know you did.
Yes, I did. I was a little disappointed with it, not grossly disappointed. I thought the colors were a little off, and I thought the picture was a little soft, but whether or not that was due to the source material or something in that complex optical chain that you just mentioned, I don't know. We'll have to wait and see. I certainly look forward to getting a sample to review.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Mark, did you get in? Oh, sorry.
I wish I had. I did not.
You were focused on audio, as I asked you to be, so thank you very much for that. Mike, what were you going to say?
I was a little disappointed, as Tom was, with the Epson, and it's not 4K, it's 4K, and they get a little cranky when you say that. And in fact, the guy really didn't take any more of my questions after I said that. I think that might account for some of the softness. Yeah. And I was actually a little disappointed that Sony didn't show any of the other laser projectors, regular laser projectors that they had at Infocom. The only one that they showed was the kind of short throw coffin, which is $50,000 and really cool. And the picture was good. But did I say it's $50,000?
Yeah, exactly. Let me get back to that Sony in a second. First of all, there's one other diagram I want to show people, which is this 4K, this pixel shifting, which I just want to make sure everybody understands what the Epson is doing. Very similar to what JVC does with their e-shift projectors, is they have a 1080p imager, and then those 2.2 million pixels are shifted by half a pixel up and half a pixel over, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, really fast, to create a pseudo 4K image. And what some of us call faux, F-A-U-X-K. It's very clever, I think. And it's supposed to sort of smooth out jagged lines and diagonals and make the image look sharper and so on and so forth. I actually went to see that demo twice. And I went once and I sat in the second row, which was third row, I guess, which was maybe 15 feet back of the 120-inch widescreen or so, something like that. And then I went again and I sat in the front row because I really wanted to look for problems and artifacts and so on. And in the native 4K content, and this is pretty cool, the projector can accept native UHP or UHD or 4K content. I thought it looked pretty good. I couldn't see any jaggies. The colors were a little off, but we're talking about a new technology here. So I was willing to be a little forgiving. Then they played some 1080p content from a Blu-ray, and I saw all kinds of artifacts at that close distance, which I attribute probably more or less to the video processing in the projector. I sort of wish they had turned that off, but they didn't. And so there was some ringing and edge enhancement kind of stuff. Looked a little strange. So, but again, this is a brand new technology. I'm willing to cut them a little slack myself. And now, Mike, you mentioned the Sony. Sony also had a laser projector there. Works in the same way. Blue lasers, some of which are, some of that blue is used to illuminate the blue imager. Some of which are, is, excites a yellow phosphor, comes out red and green, illuminates those imagers. Also reflective, they use SXRD. Epson uses liquid crystal on quartz, which is kind of their own sort of variation of that. And we have a picture of the Sony projector, VPL GTZ1, I think. Yeah. which is a super short throw projector. And it was actually outside of Sony's booth, kind of in the middle of the ambient lit show floor. So do we have that image? I thought I had that, had sent that. If not, then
my bad. What was the
name
of that one?
It's called Sony VPL GTZ1. There it is. So you can see it's this, as Mike called it, a coffin, essentially, sitting out there. It's like the edge of the box is 7 inches from the wall. And the light shines up onto this kind of special screen and shows you, I think it's a, what did they say it was? I can't remember the size of that screen. 140 inches? 147, yeah. Okay. And I agree, it looked pretty good, but it's $50,000. Yikes.
And there are other laser projectors, again, that were shown at Infocom. Some of them actually, I think that one uses a white phosphor wheel instead of yellow. But I thought the picture was pretty good. The other cool thing is, again, you've got to have some significant bracing, but you can turn that upside down and mount it to the ceiling. And in fact, in commercial applications, that's one of the applications they're pushing.
Yeah, exactly. And either way, though, you're not going to have somebody walking into the light beam as you would with a projector across the room, as most of us have. Another projector that I really wanted to show, to mention here, is from Sim2. This is an Italian company, and they brought a new LED illuminated projector using LEDs directly, red, green, and blue LEDs, to illuminate a single DLP chip. So this is using that Texas Instruments micro mirror chip. There's a picture of it. It's a nice, lovely black cubic thing. And what I found interesting was that in their demo room, they were showing both a single chip DLP with a regular lamp situation and a color wheel, which breaks that white light into red, green, and blue. And they were showing this new Nero 3, which is LED illuminated. And I ended up taking some photographs of the image on the screen from both of them. Here's one, for example. Both of these are from the movie Samsara. And hopefully you can tell the difference in color between the two. The LED projector is on the bottom. And the red is much brighter. The green is different. The yellow is somewhat different. And in the next image that I took, this is a composite, you know, where I sort of stuck the two on top of each other. Here's another moment from Samsara of a Thai or Balinese dancer. And the flesh tones of the lower image, which is from the Sim2 LED projector, the Nero 3, I thought looked very, very good. Now, they're guaranteeing 20,000 hours of life on this. So you'll probably get more, but they'll guarantee that, which Epson wasn't guaranteeing any amount of time. They were just saying, well, in eco mode, you can get up to 30,000 hours. Tom, you saw the Nero 3, didn't you?
Yeah, I didn't see the comparison you just described, but I did see the LED itself, which I was very impressed with. It's a little pricey at 14,000, but for the projector world, that's not outrageous. I could see a lot of people, especially when you don't have to replace a lamp every 2 years or something like that. But I found it a little, I thought the LED, the colors were great. I thought it was a little soft, but as I commented to you before, I think it was because it was just a huge screen they were using it on.
We should also say that the Epson LS10000, the laser projector we started with, they are quoting at the moment a price of under $8,000, which most of us speculate means $7,999.99.
Yeah.
Okay.
So. But then they said they had another one coming that was going to be about five.
Right, exactly. The LS9600E, which is also laser illuminated, just like the LS10000. It does not have 4K, this pixel shifting business. But it does have wireless HDMI. So it's got a transmitter and then a receiver inside the projector. So you don't have to run an actual HDMI cable to the projector, which is, in some cases, a very good thing. Let's see, what else was there? Digital projection had a laser projector and an LED, and I wanted to just mention those real quick. DPI, or Digital Projection International, very high-end. There, I think we might have a picture of the DPI Insight 4K laser, or Insight 4K, which they had both. Yeah, here it is. It's out on the show floor. This is a laser projector, uses the same kind of technology we were talking about before, but it outputs 12,000 lumens, so which is huge. And so they had this firing onto a screen out on the show floor. Looked fantastic, I thought. And it's only $120,000. Now, what's important is the other one. I think what's more important is the DPI Insight 4K LED, which, like the Sim 2, uses LEDs as its illumination source. And it's a DLP. Both of these are DLP projectors, three chip in this case. And the Insight 4K LED has what I think is a unique feature that could become extremely important, which is that it is able to reach what's a color gamut, a range of colors. It's able to reproduce a range of colors known as BT2020, which is one of the color gamuts that is being discussed for UHD TV. And it's the only display I've ever seen and know about that can actually reproduce this color spectrum, this color gamut, rather, BT2020, which is much greater range of colors than certainly than our current HD system, which is called BT709, also greater than the digital cinema gamut, which is called DCI or P3, alphabet soup, I know. But in any event, Tom, you saw this one as well. And yes. like me, it was way oversaturated. The colors were way oversaturated because they weren't using content that had been graded in this gamut.
Yeah, I thought it actually looked pretty dreadful myself.
I don't think I would go that far. I wouldn't go that far, but
as I mentioned to the PR rep outside afterwards, that I mentioned to him that I didn't use the word dreadful. I said I didn't think it looked very good, but I know I'm sure they're good projectors. Digital projection makes very good projectors. As you say, it was just because they had it set up wrong there, or they were basically trying to show how rich and deep and saturated the colors could be, and they were totally unnatural.
Yeah, Mike, did you get to see that one?
I just saw it in passing on the floor, but I think it's appropriate to put in a comment on one of the other panels I did. We had Grover Crisp, who's an EVP at Sony Pictures, and he's the guy that's responsible for all the restorations and the heavy-duty mastering. And somebody from the floor there asked him when we're going to see content delivered in 2020. And he said, it's a while because there are no film chains, no monitors, no workflow, and the standard isn't exactly done yet. Yeah. So I wouldn't doubt that this DPI can do 2020. The Epson claimed it, according to some people, too. I just don't believe it. And the content isn't there yet. And converting 709 content to a 2020 space is problematic.
Mm-hmm.
I also point out that the fellow that was doing the demo in the DPI room kept referring to 2020 as the Ultra HD color space or color gamut. It's not. It hasn't been decided for sure yet.
No, that's true. It is mentioned in many places, most places where they talk about UHD standardization. But you're right. It hasn't been settled upon yet. And there are reasons to argue against it, in fact, which Joe Kane has done on this very program.
I'm shocked.
So, yeah, how could you possibly be shocked about Joe Kane arguing against something? I just wanted to make sure that we covered projectors a little bit. Getting back to audio, I want to get Mark back in here with AVRs. What did you see in the way of new AV receivers, Mark? And in terms of, you know, which ones have Atmos now, which ones will be upgraded? Did you get a sense of that?
I saw a lot. Integra had, I think, the most receivers, and they also had, and I'm not going to give it away, but they had their receivers and their pre-pro maybe were the source behind some of the better demos that I heard. Coincidence or not, so. What I liked was that they had 11.2 channel, receivers, which lets you do the 7.2.4 Atmos setup, which looks like it's going to be what you want to do at home if you have the space and you can afford it. But as far as the availability of Atmos, you're right, because most of those AVRs have chips from Texas Instruments in them, and they're still waiting for a firmware update. And Denman Marantz, which went with an analog devices four-chip solution, which they talked about how they were able to keep Odyssey and implement Atmos, and that was very important to them. That the other thing that was important to them was that they could actually sell Atmos receivers at launch, like presumably before Cydia, which they are, because they already have it working. So that was different. And Marantz has receivers that can also do the 7.2.4 trick and a pre-pro. They have one receiver and one pre-pro that can do that. And that was also a great demo. So, but not everybody had that capacity. Some people like Pioneer, or specifically Pioneer, had only 9.2 receivers, which can only do a 5.2.4 or 7.2.2 Atmos setup.
Let me make sure everybody understands that what we're talking about here is sort of the speaker configuration. 7.1.4 refers to seven speakers around you, one subwoofer channel, and four speakers or Dolby-enabled upfiring speakers above you. 5.1.2 would refer to a 5.1 system around you and two overhead speakers or upfiring speakers. So that's just the nomenclature. I want to make sure everybody understands. So Pioneer, which we have a picture of some Pioneer receivers, I think, as well, AVRs. There they are. those aren't ready yet. Those don't have Atmos yet because they use the TI, Texas Instruments, DSPs. Whereas the Marantz AVR, this is the pre-pro, in fact, has it all ready to go because they are using analog devices. So, Mike, you sent me some notes about the importance of the HDMI version and HDCP, high-definition copy protection version, and how important this is. Why don't you give us a little hipness on that?
Yeah, in a word, very, because there's one other AVR that was introduced, or a series of AVRs that was introduced, which were the new Sony ES line, and they did not have Atmos. And I think when Mike Fasulo, the head of Sony, was asked about that after the keynote, he got a little uncomfortable, as if, did we miss something? And I think somebody is...
Right.
I hope that, and I don't want to be politically incorrect, somebody's going to the woodshed. Let's just leave it at that for omitting that feature. But they did have HDCP 2.2, which is what you'll need when the studios start insisting that content is protected with the latest and greatest, which gives me an opportunity to squeeze in that a big announcement from Sony was that their server, which is the FMPX10, they're going to do an upgrade and unlock it so that anybody with any display that has HDMI 2.0 and HDCP 2.2 will be able to access the native 4K content. To my mind, that's one of the biggest announcements of the show. But if you run down the list of AVRs, Onkyo and Sony have HDCP 2.2. Denon, Marantz, Pioneer, Yamaha do not, which means if you use this server for 4K content, it has two outputs, so you can sort of jerry-rig it, but it's a problem. And if further 4K products come out that don't have this dual output configuration, you're going to have an even bigger problem.
And you make such a huge point here. And I think did I send a picture of the Sony FMPX10? That is their little server box, which downloads native 4K content. There it is. From Sony Video Unlimited, and they announced also at the show that it will now stream Netflix 4K and Amazon 4K. But up until now, it's been limited. You could only use it with Sony TVs. And we were told at the show that the reason was that only Sony TVs could be guaranteed to have this HDCP 2.2 copy protection, which is somewhat hardware-based. Now that more products have this copy protection, they've decided, okay, we'll unlock it. We'll let it be used with other products as long as they have this copy protection. And Mike, you brought up something really important there, which is some of these products, some of these AVRs do not have HDCP 2.2, and that is not something that can be upgraded by firmware. That's a hardware thing.
And it's embedded in the chip. It's baked into the chip. So again, that's why the server does have two outputs. So one HDMI will go to your TV and one will go to your AVR, but other products might not. And that's a problem. The flip side of that is that the Yamaha, Pioneer, and D&M products go all the way out to the full extent of HDMI. So it in the future, when there is 60p 422 or 444 10-bit 12-bit content, sorry for the geekiness, they'll be able to handle that where the Onkyos can't. But the reality is most of the content for the early stages of 4K is going to be 2160p 8-bit 420.
Right. And sorry for all the geekiness there, but after all, this is Home Theater Geeks. No, it's totally cool with me. And I think with most of our audience, we've talked about these issues on the show before with Joe Kane and others, where the current most HDMI 2.0 products operate at a bit rate of about 10 gigabits per second. But it can go up to 18. And so those few products that have implemented 18 gigabits per second, which is, again, a hardware-related issue, there needs to be a chip that can handle that speed, then you can get higher quality UHD or 4K content with these higher specs that Mike was rattling off there. And I won't go into them right now, but I think it's another very important thing to talk about and to make sure everybody understands that when you're shopping for an AVR or a preamp processor or something that your HDMI signal is going to pass through, it should have HDMI 2.0 at 18 gigabits per second and HDCP 2.2 copy protection, which will allow all of this 4K content to flow.
The TV as well. I mean, without 2.2 on the TV, you're sunk.
Yeah. Tom, you had something to say?
No, go ahead.
Oh, no, I was talking.
Mark, sorry.
Yeah, you know, one of the funnier things at the show was Bill McKeegan from Krell, who was dragging back people back into this little alley that he had and joking that he had watches for sale. But what he was really showing was the Sony server working with his foundation preamp processor, and that he had it, you know, one cable going from the server to the processor and then one cable going to the TV. And basically, he was bragging that nobody else among the other manufacturers actually had that working, you know, with you know, in the proper fashion. So I don't know if he's absolutely accurate about that, but I do understand that other people were implementing a solution where, that used the dual HDMI outputs, and that was causing what do you want to call it? Incompetent AV system users to have to switch two inputs instead of one.
Right. But before we get to the last little bit here, I want to just touch upon whole house audio, which seems like everybody and their brother has a whole house audio, wireless audio system where it's like Sonos. Most people are familiar with Sonos. They kind of own that market. But now Core Brands, which owns Speakercraft and a bunch of others, Polk and Definitive Technology both introduced systems at the show. NAD Blue Wave is another one. Denon HEO, Samsung has one. They've all got them. But what I found interesting was when I visited the WISA booth, Wireless Speaker and Audio Technology, which is a consortium of companies working on high-resolution wireless audio streaming. I just wanted to point out that they had a Wi-Fi monitor on their computer, little antenna and a little program that was monitoring it. And I just wanted to show people that the 2.4 gigahertz band, which is the lower of the two Wi-Fi bands, if we can pull up WISA 2.4 gigahertz, we will see that on the show floor, if we can find it, there it is. It was very crowded. That frequency range was really, really crowded. And in fact, I was told by the WISA guys, I didn't go verify this elsewhere, but that a lot of these whole house audio systems weren't working because there wasn't enough bandwidth. Now, WISA works at 5 gigahertz in some sort of dedicated or reserved channels that are actually reserved for military radar. And so there's all sorts of rules that you have to follow about don't step on our toes. But if we look at the 5 gigahertz spectrum, which is also it's called WISA 5 gigahertz, should be able to see that pretty easily. And we can see when we call it up here, 3, 2, 1. I guess can't find that one. We can see that, there it is. These 5 peaks are the 5 wireless speaker systems or wireless audio systems that were operating in the WISA room, in their demo room. And we can see there's very little other traffic going on in that range. So that's one of their claims to fame. And I thought these diagrams were so cool. One would expect, you know, Wi-Fi would be very crowded in a place like Cedia.
Waiting for Scott. I'm just waiting for the EPA to declare the 2.4 and 5 gigahertz are hazardous to your health.
Yes. but why do these systems work very well in New Zealand?
Good question.
Because there's a lot of bandwidth.
I knew that was coming.
Oh, I guess I should have expected that. Oh man, made me cough.
Sorry.
Oh man. Okay. All right. Well, we only got a few minutes.
The WISA one is the only of the only one of these systems though that can do 96K audio.
Correct. Correct. 24-bit, 96K, 7.1 channels. It's primarily designed for a wireless home theater system, but they announced at the show that you could do a 5.1 home theater system and then a 2-channel multi-zone system where you could send another 2-channel signal to some other room in your house. So I thought that was kind of an interesting development as well. Okay, last couple minutes of the show. I did a little tease at the beginning, so I would like for you to, each of you, to tell me what you thought the best audio demo was at the show and the best video demo that you saw and heard. Obviously, not all of us saw and heard everything. Mark Henninger, let's start with you.
Okay, I liked the Steinway Lingdorf Atmos demo the most. And I just thought it was precise and, I'm using this new measure, which is frequency of goosebumps and frequency of tears in my eyes. And, these are ridiculous little 30-second clips that should not be emotion-provoking, so especially since I'd seen them multiple times. So I figure, hey, any system that can do that, that's a good system. So that's my vote there. Okay. And I'd like to say that, there was small room and large room. So there was also a small room system powered by an affordable receiver, and that would go to Golden Ear, which was using an Integra AVR. So,
I have to correct you. It was an Integra Pre-Pro.
He did have a Pre-Pro? Okay.
He did.
Thank you.
He did. It was the DHC 80.6. with pass lab amplifiers, which were not exactly what you'd call a real world.
In fact, we might be talking about a six-figure system anyway, thanks to the pass labs.
Yes, thanks to pass labs. But the Golden Ear speaker system that was being used was just over $10,000, which, that's a lot of money, but, compared to the mega six figures that Steinway Lingdorf is, or was at the Harman booth, it's somewhat more affordable. What about the best video that you saw?
Well, you and I forgot the booth, but there was this huge Christie projector.
In the Stewart booth.
Yes. That just was the best looking video, period.
Yep.
I thought.
Yep.
Amazing.
Yep. Mike, how about you?
Well, from a video standpoint, it's content dependent, so there's a big caveat there, and that's why I like the Sony stacked 4K projectors. But again, that was because they were using some really good native 4K 60 material, so that was pretty good. From audio, the Harman booth was pretty cool, but that was really a private DCI cinema, and a little bassy. Overly bass. They said no butt kickers here because they had 8 subs and a bazillion watts of power. I like the Golden Ears also for the money, the pass amps notwithstanding. That sounded really good.
Mm-hmm. Tom, how about you?
I'm kind of going to agree with everybody. I thought the JBL was overall the most impressive, but again, as Mike said, it was basically a small theater, not a home theater. And of the more affordable stuff, again, the Golden Ear, even with the pass amps, I'm sure if you plugged in some more modestly priced amps, it would sound almost that good.
Mm-hmm. And what about video?
Video, it had to be that the Stewart booth with the Christie projector.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I have to agree. And I also went to the Christie booth and saw their demo with essentially the same projector, and it looked equally good there. So I will say that for really high-end home theaters, the Christie projector in the Stewart booth and the Christie booth looked fantastic. I thought the Sony double-stacked VW1100 ESs also looked really good, kind of bright. But you're right, Mike, the 4K 60p, 60 frames per second content just looked fantastic. And in the more modest range of the video side, I would have to give it to the Sim 2 Nero 3, the LED projector. I just thought that looked fantastic. Best audio of the show for me, I didn't hear everything. In fact, I didn't get down to the high performance rooms at all, and I really regret that. So what I have to say is, once again, Golden Ear. I thought the Golden Ear Atmos demo was just, the sound field was cohesive and really well integrated. I normally don't prefer subwoofers in the main towers, but Sandy Gross, the designer there at Golden Ear, does do that. He prefers that approach, and it really worked in that room. I just thought the whole thing was fantastic. So there you have it, an hour's conversation about the just-finished Cedia show, which was full of news, more than we could cover here. So be sure to go to avsforum.com and soundandvision.com to read more about it. Mike, were you posting news from the show anywhere?
A couple of tweets. So anybody that's interested, I invite them to tweet me with the @CaptainVid, and I'll be following up in Residential Systems and Hidden Wires in the next month.
Excellent. So, Michael Heiss, jolly good CDA fellow. Be sure to follow him on Twitter at CaptainVid, CaptainVid. Yes, sir. And also at residentialsystems.com and hiddenwires.co.uk. Mike, thanks so much for being here.
Thanks. Happy and healthy New Year, Scott, and everyone.
And you as well. Absolutely. And Mark Henninger, thank you again for being here and doing such a fabulous job covering the audio portion of Cedia. I love working with you, man.
Oh, yeah. I love working with you too, Scott. And that was really fun, inspiring too. I learned so much at Cedia. It's amazing.
Great. Very good. And Tom Norton, a longtime friend. We've worked together for many years, and now we're on different sites, but doesn't mean we can't have a loads of fun together. Thanks so much for being here.
Yeah, thanks, Scott, and happy Halloween.
Yes, another important part, another important holiday here today. Absolutely. So again, that's Michael Heiss. He's at residentialsystems.com and CaptainVid on Twitter. Mark Henninger, you can find him at avsforum.com and avsforum on Twitter. And Tom Norton's at soundandvision.com. You can find me, of course, also at avsforum.com. You can email me at scott@twit.tv. And you can follow me on Twitter at htgeekscott. And also, I will recommend again AVS Forum. You can always find previous episodes of Home Theater Geeks right here at twit.tv/htg and also on our YouTube channel at youtube.com/twit/HomeTheaterGeeks. Next week, my guest geek is scheduled to be Dennis Erskine, a very well-known custom installer, well-known among AVS members in particular, and we're going to be talking about some of his installation projects, so I do hope you will join me for that. Until then, geek out.